And it's my distinct honor and pleasure to be before you today. I really debated where to start my story. It was a hard decision for me because I really don't really talk about who I am and what drives me. But I felt like if I was going to be authentically before you today, I had to start my story where it really mattered. See, I am the fourth generation from slavery in the United States on my mother's side. Think about that. My great-grandparents were slaves. And I mention slavery, and I start with slavery, because the slave trade was a business. It was built on capitalism, first mercantilism, and then capitalism. It spawned all kinds of related industries. So you had your slavers, you had your distributors, you had your shippers. But it was based on a product and a service that undercut the humanity of generations of people. There were investors involved in the slave trade. You had insurance companies that were insuring the slavers, that were insuring the ships. You had universities and large equity investors that were investing in these companies that traded in human beings. And so my question for you, and the question that I'll answer towards the end of my conversation today, is that the integrity of the products and services, does it matter? Does it matter? Does it matter? Behind me, you see a picture of my mother's family. Sitting in the middle is my grandfather and my grandmother, Ira Brown and Pearlie May. And there's my mother as the young woman. She's the youngest girl sitting between her older sister, my Aunt Irma Jean, who lives in San Diego, and her father. Now, I really look at this picture and I used to wonder. I was just like, wow. You know, he was only the second generation from slavery. They were the children of people held as slaves. And they were really faced with an existential question. And that question is, how do you go from being capital, essentially being used as free labor, to build wealth for Anglo-Saxon families, for Anglo-Saxon businesses, and for Anglo-Saxon nations, to actually becoming and having to earn a living in a capitalist system within one generation? They had to figure it out. They had to figure it out with literally no help. Now, the place that they lived in was a town called Paducah, Texas. And that is during a time where cotton was king. And so they figured it out. They figured out that faith mattered, that family mattered, that a whole lot of hard work mattered, and education really mattered. And my brother and sister and I, we actually had a completely different upbringing, thanks, believe it or not, to the Vietnam War. My father went into the Air Force, and we grew up living literally all around the world, in many places across the United States and overseas. And every 2 years, we would move to a new place. And while I was familiar, because I would go home to where my parents were from, I was familiar with inequity from the standpoint of race and class. Being able to live all over the world made me familiar and to understand that exclusion exists wherever human beings are. And that exclusion might operate according to gender, it might operate according to indigenous status, it might operate according to religion. But exclusion works in similar ways all around the world. And then I became interested, how do we solve for discrimination? How do we build a better world where there are no excluded peoples, that where we have opportunities for people to have opportunities from all backgrounds? And so I became inspired to actually create what is now a B Corp called Global Policy Solutions. And I get to live every day dealing with issues related to health, education, economic security, civic engagement, and to actually integrate strategies in ways that matter for people and their environments. Our mission is to make policy work for people and their environments. Well, 8 years ago, I married a man. A man who is just as deeply passionate as I am. And he happens to represent the town of Baltimore and surrounding areas in Congress. And so several months ago, how many of you remember the uprising, the unrest in Baltimore, that it was being covered on CNN on almost 24-hour basis? Well, you know, the CVS that burned down on the corner of North Avenue in Pennsylvania is literally only five blocks from our house in Baltimore. This is our neighborhood that you saw on television. So my husband, seeking to prevent, you know, people from being arrested unduly, and because we see every day the inequities that exist in Baltimore. Baltimore is literally a city where structural racism exists in the geopolitical space. You can see it in the neighborhoods, literally, where across the street you will have African Americans who are low income concentrated, and then across another street you'll have people who have vast prosperity, opportunity, and wealth, literally living next door to each other, but so far from each other in terms of experiences and opportunities. And so that's our neighborhood you saw on television. And so with that, you know, my husband would go out at night. There was a curfew, and he wanted to get out there before the 10 o'clock curfew hit because he wanted to prevent people from actually having a clash with the police. So at that corner, you actually had young people out there who were really focused on, you know, really addressing the police because, frankly, the people of Baltimore were frustrated. They were frustrated because they believe and we believe that black lives matter. And yet in the city of Baltimore, you had a situation where a 25-year-old young African-American male sitting on his doorstep was detained by the Baltimore City Police and taken into custody in a van, and somewhere in the space of being taken into that van and his arrival at the other end of that trip, he had his larynx, his voice box crushed, and he had his spine severed. And people were saying, that is absolutely not right. And not only that, but we're being treated like this by the criminal justice system on a daily basis. Now, if you know Baltimore, you also know that the schools, there's been a disinvestment in schools, that the tax base is really low, that you actually have high rates of poverty, that you have entire neighborhoods that have been disinvested in. And so the question becomes for them is, not only do you not respect my life, as evidenced by how the police treat us on a daily basis, but you don't respect any of our lives as evidenced by how our neighborhoods looked and what we have to put up with in terms of sub-rate services. And so with that, you know, the kids know that they're being warehoused. You know, you have we visited schools where children were saying, you know, I want to be a nurse, and yet my school, and it requires that we have certain math courses, and yet my school has slots for six math teachers, and we only have two. I know I'm not being prepared for what I desire to be in this world. Another young man came up to my spouse while we were out on the street corner, and he said, sometimes I feel like I'm in my coffin trying to claw my way out on a daily basis. These are young people who feel hopeless, who feel a level of despair. And guess what? We have these young people in the United States, in cities and towns across the country, because the phenomena that Baltimore is experiencing is a phenomena that also exists in other places around the country. Now, this is a massive problem for several reasons. The fact of the matter is how many of you know that for every baby born in America today, a majority are black and brown? That by the year 2019, a majority of children under the age of 18 are black and brown. And that by the year 2043, a majority of the United States of America's population will be black or brown. Now, these are people who have historically been on the margins of the U.S. economy. They have been, they are from households who have little wealth. Did you know that fully 80% of African American and Latino households actually have incomes, median net worth, that fall below the median net wealth of white households? Did you know that for every dollar of wealth held by the typical white family, the typical African American family only owns 6 cents, and the typical Latino family only owns 7 cents? Now, I talk about these statistics everywhere I go as part of what I do, and usually people say, oh, but poverty is poverty, and it doesn't matter what race you are. But guess what? Did you know that even poverty is experienced differently by race and ethnicity? If you look at the lowest income quintile, Latinos only have 7%, poor Latinos only have 7% of the wealth of poor whites. And African Americans, poor African Americans, have 0% of the wealth of whites. Now, you can dismiss the statistics, but with a growing population of racial and ethnic, quote-unquote, minorities, and them being on the margins of the economy, you can guarantee that if we don't do something about this, we'll actually have a nation that looks something like apartheid South Africa in the not-too-distant future. And that should be simply unacceptable to B Corps and all of us who care about the future of this country. Now, why should B Corps care, and what can B Corps do? The fact of the matter is, and that, of course, is another picture of the young people who were protesting on the streets of Baltimore, and you will notice the disregard that they have for the law. And that disregard will only spread if we don't do something about it. So we have to raise the race conversation, and we have to be focused on an inclusion revolution. B Corps can be at the forefront of embracing the notion that not only should we be focused on inclusion, but we should be focused on diversity and inclusion. And I've got to tell you that it hurts my heart to no end when I see pictures of teams and there is no discernible racial and ethnic diversity anywhere to be seen on the screen or in the picture. That suggests to me that the notion of diversity and inclusion has yet to sink in as another way to boost your score on the assessment. And so I encourage us to think differently about how we're thinking and how we're relating to diverse populations. I encourage you to build your team's capacity to actually engage diversity and inclusion, to actually hire diverse staff, and actually to actually foster diverse supply chains. And however you do that will be welcome, because frankly, we need it. We need it in order for everybody to feel like they're affirmed and respected. So how many of you all remember this guy? Howard Schultz, the CEO and chairman of Starbucks. He launched this initiative called Race Together because he decided to put himself and his company out on the line to say that diversity and inclusion matters, and he was going to take it in his hands to actually do something about it. Well, what happened? Within the space of 2 weeks, they rolled back the initiative. There was, a little bit of shame in terms of, the initiative not necessarily working. And, they shifted directions. Now, imagine if the B Corp movement, now, I don't know if this particular concept would have made a difference because, frankly, baristas at the coffee shop, they're not trained in social work, they're not psychologists, and to actually have them trying to engage customers in questions about diversity and inclusion and race and ethnicity, that might have been a little bit half-baked. But the intent was great. The intent was great. And if it had been a different concept that was actually developed in collaboration with a whole host of players like yourselves in the room, and you all stepped out together, would it have been a success? And could it have been a success? And I argue yes, and that brings me to my second point about how we can achieve an inclusion revolution as a B Corp movement. And that is to focus on collective impact. Collective impact. Now, we've already heard the importance of B2B, B Corps working with B Corps, but B Corps exist in places and spaces. You all have a local presence, and we're all connected through this network globally. But it's often in the places and spaces that we see exclusion operating at its most pernicious level. And so with that, you have to actually step out as leaders, and I encourage you to think about stepping out as leaders to work cross sectors in order to make a difference. And so I also would like to argue that products and the integrity of products and services matter. And so we have to focus on making sure that the products and services are treating all people in all communities equally. Literally in Baltimore, we had a situation in the mortgage market where if you were African American and purchasing a home, you were charged more than whites, even if you had higher credit scores and even if you had higher income. And the data shows that. Now, businesses shouldn't show up like that, actively discriminating against populations. And so business products, practices, and certainly services matter. So I'm just going to end by sharing a short story. Several years ago, I visited my friends in Valence, France. And they said, let's go hiking. I said, sure. And we were hiking across the hills and dales of southeastern France. And we stumbled upon a city called Haute Reef. And, you know, there was a big sign that said, you know, Le Palais Ideal, that way. And so we decided to go explore. And it was actually an amazing story. In 1879, a postman named Le Facteur Cheval, the postman Cheval, actually stumbled upon an odd-shaped rock during his daily postal route. And he went home that night and he had a dream. He had a dream that he would collect rocks and build this huge palace. And so on his daily trips, he would bring a wheelbarrow with him, and he would collect rocks wherever he went. He would take it back to his humble abode, and then he would dump the rocks in the backyard. Pretty soon, he started putting the rocks together, putting them together with mortar. And then he started creating all kinds of fanciful shapes and all kinds of international reference into what became a beautiful palace. That palace actually inspired the surrealism movement, and it's become a national monument. If you ever go to France, I encourage you to go visit it. Well, I actually believe that Jay, Bart, and Andrew are the Le Facteur Chevals of this movement. They stumbled on a rock, and they decided to build. But each and every one of you are part of building this palace, this new place, this new vision for creating a new form of capitalism that's inclusive and diverse. And so I just want to encourage you and thank you for being the kind of people with the kind of values that can really make a difference in the world. So let's go out and do it. Thanks.